everybody. Good morning. Nice to see everyone here this morning. Good to have you all here at 11:11. It's nice to have some visitors, to see some visitors here. It's good to have you all here. The visitors, don't forget, if y'all are visiting, make sure you grab one of these things on your way up. Marty's in the back, and we'd love to give you one of our tumblers as a way of remembering us, and also because this fits really well with our theme today. We're going to be talking about prayer here in 11:11, and sip, breathe, smile, of course, is part of the slogan that our good friend Brian Jolin came up with when he put these things together. So make sure you grab one of those on the way out. And if you're a member and you don't have one of our regulars and you don't have one, you can buy one. Yeah, you can buy one too. Okay, and then online, we're glad to see you there online, and please make sure you register your attendance there. You can do that online. You can do that in here with a card. You can do that by scanning your phone on the scan code. You can also scan the code on the bulletin and find all sorts of opportunities and ways to get involved with this community and with First United Methodist Church as well in different activities that we're doing, the Taste Project, small group stuff. All that's there too. All right, we got an interesting conversation this morning, and I'm glad to have Cynthia Powell with us this morning. She spoke with us once before, about several months ago, and teaches at UNT, the Health Science Center, and teaches mindfulness training, and particularly with regard to stress reduction and leadership and team development, all those good things at the Health Science Center. And we've invited her to talk with her about that as well. But this morning, we're going to think about prayer. I wanted to get us started off with a really helpful way of thinking about prayer, I think. There was a woman who was driving around in the parking lot. You've had this experience. You've been driving around the parking lot. You can't find a parking space. You're trying to make your way to the store. It's crowded. You don't want to end all the way at the other end, especially now in this heat. So she's driving around, and she's just like finding nothing. 10 minutes of circling and circling and circling. Back of her mind, she starts thinking, oh, Lord, you know what, God? Just give me a space. Just give me a space. And then she starts to make promises, you know, a little bit of bargaining. You know, if you give me a space, if I get a space, God, then I'll come to church more regularly. Yeah, I'll give more. I'll do some more service time during the week. If you'll give me a space, I'm going to turn the corner. If you'll give me a space, I'm just going to turn right here close. If you give me a space, and then just then she sees a space open and she says, never mind, God, I found one myself. Now, if you look at my little Mini Cooper, something that Kirk and Linda Stoley gave me years ago, if you look on the dash of my Mini Cooper, I have my little dancing Jesus. I have my little dancing Jesus. And I my dancing Jesus is there because it's kind of my own little personal Jesus. But not in the same way. More in the way of sort of mocking me whenever I go there. More in the way of sort of challenging me whenever I start to get too concrete. Because it's a little too playful. It's a little too sarcastic. A little too ironic or satirical for me to really take that idea seriously. And yet then, how do I take something seriously? So we're thinking about prayer, and the particular question that I want to come up with is one that came up last week during our annual Q&A. During our annual Q&A, someone asked the question, in the process of having deconstructed their faith, which is where a lot of us have been over the years, not necessarily knowing exactly how to reconstruct it in a different way or a new way, but after having deconstructed faith, the idea then, the question came up then, what is prayer if there is no God up there? Okay, no God out there, no God up there. What is prayer? What is prayer if God is everything and everywhere? What is prayer? So, kind of an interesting question. You want to leave now? You can leave now if you'd like. Nobody wants to leave? We're okay? We're okay still? All right. Yeah, you're still online with me? All right, so we'll start off with the question, as we always do, personal Jesus.
Reach out, touch faith. Your own personal Jesus. Someone to hear your prayers. Someone who cares. There.
put me to the test. Things on your chest you need to confess. I will deliver, you know I'm a forgiver. Reach out, touch faith.
Yes, is that better? Okay. Okay, welcome. Welcome, travelers. Let me see if I can do that. Oh, look. I got it, though. Join us in our welcome candle. Come, come, whoever you are, wanderer, worshiper, lover of leaving. It doesn't matter. Ours is not a caravan of despair. Come, even if you have broken your vows 1,000 times, come yet again.
1111, would y'all stand and sing a song with us now? It's a good old solid 1111 sing along here. Of course, this is your time to bring the offering on up to the table as well. Words up there on the screen if you don't know it. First one right here.
You may be watching from a safe distance. You may be so close you can taste the blood. You may have headed for higher ground. Now you may be drowning in the flood. Your heart, you may be pulling yourself together again. You may one of you can recognize her face. One of you runs to her with open arms. One of you falls down in disgrace.
Verse 3.
You may see a million different gateways home. You may think there's only one way through. May be waiting for the kingdom to come. You may believe it's in you. No matter what you do,
that's a rocker, man. Come on.
Yeah.
Would y'all take a moment and offer one another a sign of peace, please?
All right, so good to see you all, and good to see some visitors here again, and good to have you guys online as well. I hope you were able to go get the bulletin. If you're online with Facebook, I know Nancy Derringer probably posted that up there where you could find the bulletin. If you're on the website, the church website, you can find this bulletin by going to back to the church main page, and then you'll see where it says worship, and then down below, when you go below the worship, they'll have bulletins there. Click that, and you'll see the bulletin. And that just kind of helps you know what's coming up next, as well as to read these particular texts with me. Our scripture this morning, I wanted to read it in particular because I had a very unique reason for having these two texts, some of which I'll get to later. But we did this one text last week. Jay Anthus is not here this morning, but Jay read that. It's one of my favorite sort of tongue twister texts that Paul uses in trying to explain what it means to be related to Jesus now, I mean back then, in relation to the law, and also in the context of a Greco-Roman culture. So Greco-Roman culture had a very dualistic way of understanding things, mind and body, very split. That wasn't necessarily true in the Old Testament. Old Testament was much more mixed. Old Testament, Moses be walking along and a bush turns on fire and there's God. Somebody's up in a mountain and wind blows and there's God. You know, you're walking along and you've been out in the woods, I mean out in the desert for 40 years, and God shows up as manna from heaven. I mean, in the Old Testament, God is kind of an everywhere, everything kind of experience. It just requires you to be focused on something in particular. We'll talk about that. In the New Testament, Paul's trying to make sense, and he's talking to Romans who are converting. He's talking to Jews who have the law, and he's trying to make sense of all of it, so he writes this text. I do not understand my own actions, for I do not do what I want, but I do the very thing I hate. Now, if I do not do what I ought do, but instead what I ought do, I do not, then I agree that the law, it twisted Jay's tongues last week too. Now, if I do not do what I ought do, but do instead what I ought not, then I agree that the law is good. For in fact, it is no longer I who do the sin, but sin that dwells within me. For I know that the good does not dwell within me, that is, in my flesh, but the desire to do good lies close at hand, but not the ability. For I do not do the good I want, but the evil I do not want is what I do. Now, it's confusing, right? But don't tell me you haven't thought this. Why did I do that again? Why do I keep finding myself in this same pattern? Why am I stuck with this habit? Why can't I do the thing I know I need to do? I mean, we've been there, right? We are just like Paul. We think it's somebody else's fault. We think it's something else, and the good's just out of my reach. So then I came to Psalms 23. We know this psalm. You hear it at a lot of funerals. Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. Leadeth me to lie down in green pastures. And there's this sense in which God is doing this stuff for us. But I took an idea, which we've talked about in here many times, which is God is the very ground of our being. God is being itself. God is beyond being. God is mystery. Why are we even using the word God? It gets so confusing when we start getting there. And if we take that orientation then, that we live and move and have our being in this divine reality, then what does Psalm 23 look like? Psalm 23. So I adapted it 2,400 years later. Attentive to the ground of my being, I am content. I rest in sweet grass and lie down by calm waters and am refreshed. I follow the path of justice, the path that unfolds in the pattern of shalom. When I walk in the midst of my own mortality, even death itself, I am not afraid, for I am in the presence of holiness. I am comforted attending to my steps and the wisdom each step reveals. Even in the midst of adversity, the table of life is set. A feast of unknown delight, inviting it all in. I am certain my cup is empty, and then discover I'm embraced by an abundance and followed by this kindness and goodness. And I will live my days in the eternal mystery of it all. Psalm 23, from the ground of being.
When I was a girl each week, Sunday we would go to church and pay attention to the priest as he would read the holy word and consecrate the holy bread, everyone kneel and bow. Today the only difference is everything is holy now. Everything is holy now. When I was in Sunday school, we would learn about the time Moses split the sea in two, and Jesus made the water wide. I remember feeling sad. Miracles don't happen still. But now I can't keep track, 'cause everything's a miracle. Everything's a miracle. Wine from water is not so small. that a magic trick, anything is here at home. You saw a challenging thing becomes not to look for miracles, finding where there isn't one. When holy water was rare at best, I could barely wet my fingertips. Now I have to hold my breath, like I'm swimming in a sea of it. Used to be a world half there, heaven's second rate hand me down. I walk with a reverent air, 'cause everything is holy now. Shining like a burning bush, and singing like a scripture verse, made me want to bow my head, 'cause I remember when church let out, how things have changed since then, 'cause everything is holy now. Used to be a world half there, heaven's second rate hand me down. I walk with a reverent air, holy now.
One of my favorite songs by our good friend Peter Mayer up in Minnesota. Let me see where these stools are. They're not back here. Oh, you know where they are? I'm sorry. Would you do me a favor, guys? Would y'all reach behind you? I think the two stools are right back there. Have they moved the stools? Okay. No stools back there. That's interesting. I should have done this beforehand, obviously. Worst case scenario, those chairs. Now, just go ahead. Yeah, we'll take that stool. Okay, we'll take that stool and that stool. That's good. All right. Here we go. Here, would you like to have the back? Okay. I'll have this one. Yes. All right. And I think what we'll do is I think we'll let you use her microphone and just bring it towards you there. And then I'll use the headset. I'm so glad to have Cynthia here with us this morning and to talk with us about this idea of prayer, and we're just to kind of have a conversation. And the reason in particular that I wanted Cynthia is because I know her to be an expert in mindfulness training. And something I have been practicing over the last couple of years is this idea of mindfulness. And, of course, I throw in a little bit of more of a traditional kind of Buddhist sitting meditation at the same time. But it's very much the same. They very much overlap with this idea of mindfulness. And then to think about how does that influence what is prayer? And the problem, of course, is this idea that if prayer, we have this understanding of prayer, if in a traditional sense, that it's about sort of engaging something beyond us or something out there to take care of something or to fix something. We often think of it in traditional terms. You know, the way I used to learn, the way I learned it in seminary was you had the acronym ACTS, to sort of remind you of the four traditional, the four traditional forms of prayer: adoration, confession, thanksgiving, supplication. Supplication being more the stress, anxiety, sadness, fear, anxious, entreating God or asking God to do something, to fix something, to help with something, or to deal with something beyond us even, like the problems in the world, for example. But it oftentimes ends up being pretty much the dominant way in which we pray. You know, we sort of don't even think about praying until we have a problem. But again, all of this is that sort of Descartesian understanding of prayer. This idea that I can't do anything myself, but it's not far from me. I can, you know, the good is right there. I just need to invite the good in. And what I want to suggest is more, instead of the old idea of original sin, which is an idea that came about actually closer to the 4th century, not so much in Jesus, even in Jesus' own teachings, but more Augustine, and then the early church after Augustine kind of adopted this, again, this separation of mind and body. And we'll see, as you talk about the Catholic Church, that idea of separation continued. There's an aspect of control in separation when we separate things. There's also an aspect of abdication. We sort of give away things, actually, when we don't deal with them deeply and personally and intimately. So this whole idea of changing my mind about prayer, actually also rooted in the Old Testament, the prophetic tradition. Jeremiah speaks to Josiah as he's taken over the leadership, and his father had been the king, and everything had been pretty good, but now things were falling apart, and Jeremiah reminds Josiah, he actually says, okay, do you remember how your father used to sit with the poor? Do you remember how your father used to eat with those who were hungry? Do you remember how your father did that? And that was God. That was God. Loving those people was God. That's it. Jeremiah said that. Well, we know that prophetic tradition. Micah said it too. What does the Lord require of you? Not this other stuff. Not all this decorative stuff. Not even these rituals. What does God require of you but to love justice, which means right relationship, which is the path of shalom. Love justice, walk, and love mercy, and walk humbly with God. Justice, mercy, humility, relationship, how we live in relationship. Jesus talked about the very same thing, right? He was in that same prophetic tradition. So then the question came to me then, that, you know, when I was listening, this question that was asked last week when I started thinking about it, well then, how do we do prayer then? What even does prayer mean if it's no longer about something beyond us, but now something in the very ground of our being? And so we're kind of just thinking about prayer. And we may not even come down on the same, rock or point when it comes to talking about prayer. We may have diverging ideas. You may have diverging ideas when it comes to prayer. Mm-hmm. And that's fine. But as we've talked about deconstruction in here, and as people have come to me and over the years joined in here because they're at that place of where traditional church no longer spoke to them, or they had a bad experience at church, all those different things. Refugees from traditional church, so to speak, maybe. Spiritual refugees. Come here, and then how do we refigure this then? Do we just throw it all out? Do we just throw the old concepts out, the old doctrines out, the old teachings out, all that stuff? Do we throw it out? Mm-hmm. So share with us how it's changed for you over the years, because you grew up Catholic.
I did. Good morning, everyone. I was brought up Catholic, and in my family, it was a rather unspoken rule that you are Catholic, and that unless you're sick, you're going to church, and if you have any even thought of sin, then going to confession and so forth. So it was very rules-based, and I remember, you know, asking my parents as I was growing up, could you share with me a little bit about your faith beliefs, you know, and the response I got is, well, this is my faith, or this is my religion. So we never really discussed it in great detail. So I grew up knowing, okay, this is something I have to do. And once I moved out of the house is when I really took the independence and to explore. So I started looking into other churches, denominational, non-denominational, still kept my faith. But I was searching for something that was the right fit for me. So typically when I left the Catholic Church, and I'm not trying to speak negatively about the Catholic Church, this is my experience, I would feel either guilty or I'd feel nothing. And that's not what I wanted as part of my belief system, as part of my faith. So I remember actually having a conversation with my mom when I was in my early 20s, and she said, well, what exactly are you looking for, you know, in your religion or your church experience? And I said, you know, I want a celebration of my faith. That's what I want. And she said, well, you know, it's not a party. So that...
It's just a little bit.
Sure.
And lower it just a little bit, so it's a little more direct, so there you go. Yeah, there we go. Thanks. So it's not a party.
It's not a party. And it just took me some time to really reflect on what was important to me. And even though my family is still very devout Catholic, and I respect that, but it was really important for me to find my own path. And, so again, looking into different churches, keeping my faith, sometimes not going to church at all. But I found a wonderful group of friends who were going to a Methodist church. This was when I was living in Northern Virginia. And it really helped me to find that sense of community. And I found it to be a celebration of faith. And it doesn't mean that you don't ask the hard questions. It doesn't mean that, having faith and living in this way, in a Christian way, is easy or simple. But I really, for the first time, I feel like in my life, had a sense of community and connection and a celebration of what my faith is.
Can you share with us a little bit about what that was? Because I hear that a lot when people are looking for church, or for, one thing that comes up is community.
Yes.
Occasionally, depending on how attached we are to concepts, like beliefs in the sense of concrete sort of statements.
Yes.
Then we can be fairly defensive about things, especially these days as we get more and more identity oriented to whatever it is. And so when you say Catholic Church apparently felt very distant and disconnected for you.
Yes.
So when you were looking for, what did you experience in that church that you decided, this is good, I like this?
Feelings-wise,
emotionally-wise.
Sure. I felt more welcome. I felt there was more of an open, welcoming attitude and experience. I felt that it was a place to really explore different ideas and concepts and experiences. It was less rule-driven. And that was really what I was looking for. And it was a place where you could openly express yourself. And just as an example, when I was growing up, I was really upset about something that was going on for me medically. And I remember sharing, with my parents that I was angry. And that was hard to do when I was growing up, to talk about negative things. The focus a lot was on positive. So I remember, my mom saying something like, well, God works in mysterious ways, or something like that. And I remember making a comment, well, it's not doing such a great job for me right now. And she said, oh, you can't be angry at God. And I said, well, why can't I be angry at God? And then my dad overheard part of this conversation, and he came into the room, and he said, what's going on? And I shared with him, and it took quite a bit of courage to do that. I'm really upset about this that I'm dealing with. And he said, well, what about all the starving children in Africa? I love my parents very much, and they were very encouraging and supportive and loving. It's a different viewpoint about faith, and I believe it is okay to be angry and to express different emotions. And I know oftentimes people refer to God or the Father. I don't. I refer to the higher power as divine or my creator. In my view, it transcends gender. So I don't refer to he or she or they. It's the divine or the creator or my higher power.
So a couple of things play with.
Sure.
That you mentioned.
Sure.
The first thing was anger.
Yes.
And so, there's plenty of anger towards God in the Old Testament, and especially in the Psalms, which are a great sort of model of Old Testament prayer. The different lamentations and confession and praise and all of that is present there.
Mm-hmm.
There's a lot of anger that shows up too.
Mm-hmm.
Doesn't make it one way or the other. Doesn't make it wrong or right. It's
right.
Just expressing, right?
Exactly.
But here's the thing. What is it when you're angry, and you can be angry at God, what is it, if you unpack what the anger's about, what is that? Where does that find its anchor?
For me, in that particular experience, it was a feeling of frustration and fear and not being able to openly express myself. And I did speak with a counselor, and that was really helpful, and she helped me to identify that being angry about what I was going through was healthy. And so I think it is okay to express, to have that full range of emotion. And emotion is really data to an extent. It's communicating to us.
Yeah.
So I tend not to think of negative emotions or positive emotions, just emotions. And really so important having that mind-body connection, which took a while for me to develop, because oftentimes I could easily go cognitive. I could easily tell you what I think. It wasn't as easy to tell you how I feel.
That's a great insight, especially when it comes to thinking about how we get attached to certain concepts or certain ideas or certain traditions.
Yes.
Like if you'd grown up Catholic, very much you had some very specific rules and beliefs and concrete sort of things you had to attach to.
Yes.
Heaven and hell, you know, I mean,
oh, yes.
and purgatory.
Oh, yes.
And you know, all of the stuff that was ritually anchored in your brain,
right.
Very cognitive. But it doesn't really speak to the emotional, to the physical, to the neurobiological that's going on.
Yes.
So that when you identify anger and you're angry at God, you're also really angry at who?
At the situation, too.
At the situation.
Yes.
At yourself.
Yes.
You know, because you actually had to, eventually, when you had the opportunity to talk.
Yes.
To talk openly, authentically. Now, from the ground of being perspective, we call that confessional prayer. Does that make sense?
It does.
You know, I mean, that's kind of when we, you know, I think about the AA groups, and you know, I was involved in Al-Anon for a number of years, and one of the most profound sort of experiences was this corporal confession that went on in community. It was shared. It was private. You know, that was all kept confidential in the group, obviously, but the group itself acted as a conduit for confession. But the confession was never about sort of like, oh, I got that off my chest.
Right.
It was really about, oh, that's me. It was really about self-awareness.
Yes.
And the more we were able to do that, then the challenge became forgiveness.
Yes.
And if we could forgive ourselves, we could move forward in a way that was healing beyond us too. And so that whole act, I mean, confession, forgiveness, all of those things are important aspects of prayer.
Mm-hmm.
And we say them in church, in traditional church all the time, your sins are forgiven, you know, that sort of thing, and we have confession.
Right.
But the thing that's missing, I think oftentimes, self-forgiveness. Paul Tillich, the theologian, German theologian, called the ultimate thing that is necessary for salvation, for wholeness, for being redeemed, is self-acceptance.
Mm-hmm.
Deep, honest self-acceptance.
Yes.
And so, you know, so the reason I bring it up is because I think it also leads into why mindfulness is such a helpful tool.
I agree. And if I could share just a really brief story about my first experience with like a mindset shift. I was in the hospital. I had major abdominal surgery. This was when I was in my early 20s, connected to my medical condition. And there were some complications, and I was throwing up. I wasn't keeping anything down. They were talking about putting a tube down my throat, me being there for several more days. And I really got very angry and depressed and frustrated. And I remember a nurse came into my room one evening, and she asked me, how are you doing? I said, I'm angry. I can't remember exactly what I shared with her, but I shared, I'm angry. I'm frustrated by this. I may have even said I'm angry with God. And she really helped me during that conversation. This is not verbatim, but she was encouraging me to focus instead on what I'm looking forward to. Instead of focusing on the frustration and the anger and so forth, what are you looking forward to? You know, what might you be grateful for? And during that conversation, she was sharing with me, you know, that she had gone to Africa and that she adopted a child. And I really had a great connection, a great conversation with her. And I did. I was like, okay, let me give this a try. So being angry is really not helping me all that much. I'm not getting better. So I shifted my mindset and started thinking about things I wanted to do, getting out of the hospital, going back to school, being with my friends, and so forth. And the next morning, I was able to keep things down. My condition improved. I went home same time that was expected. And I remember the last day when I was in the hospital, I wanted to say thank you, you know, to that nurse for that conversation. And so I asked like the charge nurse, you know, actually the nurse's name was Cindy, who came into the room. And so I said, you know, is Cindy here by chance? I just wanted to say goodbye and thank her. And she said, we don't have a Cindy on this floor. for me, that was an example of an angel. And I do believe in angels. I do believe that they're among us. But that was the connection for me, to an extent, between being mindful and intentional, and then also my connection with my faith and my spirituality.
Yeah, I think the one thing that I think struck me with that is, and I've heard similar stories from other folks in the hospital, mm-hmm. which is a very difficult place to be.
Yes.
It's a confrontation with literally what is probably the most determinative, hampering, and if not truly self-aware about it, the most limiting reality of our emotions, and that's fear,
mm-hmm.
our mortality.
Yes.
Our mortality permeates everything about who we are, even though we don't always sit around going like, oh, I think I'm dying, or I think I'm going to die, or I know I'm going to die at some point. You know, and so when you're confronted with this reality of your health fragility and mortality,
yes.
It's a shock.
Mm-hmm.
It's a shock,
mm-hmm.
and it upturns everything in our foundation, sort of the foundation of our psyche and emotional system.
Absolutely.
Which is why my doctor always says when we have visits, because I always talk to him. You know me; I'm the one that is always promoting that app called We Croak that reminds you five times a day we're going to die. And I can't get anybody to get into it. I can't get anybody to pick up on it. I don't know, you know, but every now and then someone does, and it's like, wow, that's changed my mind. So I talked to my doctor about this, and he says, I wish everybody thought about their death every day. That's my internal medicine specialist that said that. He said, not enough people think about that. But I don't think he was being morbid at all. I think he was being very authentic and honest that the thing we're most afraid of is the thing that drives us. And we see it all around us politically, we see it all around us emotionally, we see it all around us religiously. The thing that we fear most deeply and won't connect with often mm-hmm. is the thing that's driving us
mm-hmm.
and drives our theology and everything.
Right.
So you had a personal experience of experiencing mind, body, and how that fear literally reframes how your body acts.
Yes.
And how you react to it.
Yes. And one more story, a brief one. I remember this was a handful of years ago when I was living in the D.C. area, and I was really stressed out about a situation at work, and I was on the verge of a panic attack. I was at home by myself, and I got still. I was able to just get very still, and a voice within said, focus on faith, not on fear. And so, like, okay. So I just kept repeating that. And that prevented me from going into a panic attack. It helped me to remain calm. And that's oftentimes something that I repeat to myself when I'm feeling really stressed or anxious about something. Focus on faith, not on fear. And fear isn't necessarily a negative thing or a bad thing. Fear can actually really serve us. I mean, our bodies are designed to protect us, to keep us alive. So fear, when it's not serving me, I repeat to myself, fear is fictional events that appear real.
So let's jump ahead then. Let's segue that into how mindfulness helps with this mind-body split and with maybe being more present to what's sacred in our midst.
Right.
How would you see mindfulness helping that?
Well,
your practice?
And research has shown actually that our minds wander about 50% of the time.
That's all?
Yeah, maybe okay. More. Maybe yeah. For some people,
yeah.
Maybe
I'm,
more.
I'm 75, not 85%, yeah.
So when we're not in the present moment, you know, we're on autopilot. You know, we're rehashing the past or rehearsing the future. And our lives are literally passing us by moment. But there are other things to be aware of when we're on autopilot. We may be carrying stress and tension in our bodies without even being aware of it. We may be missing out on critical information that we need to make a really important decision. We might be missing out on some beautiful moments in our lives that bring real meaning and purpose. So I am so grateful for my mindfulness practice. It's a daily part of my life. It's hard for me to imagine my life without it. It wasn't instant. It took time. It is a practice. There's no such thing as perfection when it comes to mindfulness. That's why it's referred to as a practice. So I'm very grateful for it. And it doesn't mean that you don't experience or I don't experience challenges or difficult times. However, when we are being present, we're much more in a position to tap into our creativity and our intuition. and make a wise choice versus a reactive choice that's really connected to fear.
Would you go so far as to say that if Paul knew mindfulness, he might not think that that goodness was outside of himself, but he just hadn't reached deep enough inside?
I think it's very possible, yes.
Booyah, there we go, all right, yeah. Mindfulness interpretation of scripture.
That's right.
Okay, so we've got a few minutes left, and the band, don't come up just yet, band, but I'm going to invite you to lead. She's going to lead us in a reflective sort of loving kindness practice. There's a number of different ways of doing sort of mindfulness prayers, and loving kindness is one that actually comes out of the Eastern tradition, but has been adopted now by a lot of Western traditions and practices. And there's a number of tools that we really have available to us, like the Lord's Prayer is an interesting and helpful tool. If you can get out of the patriarchal sort of kingdom language, you can get into the what is present now. The kingdom that represents shalom is here and now. That's what we pray for. That's what we live for. That's how we live into it. And so the Psalms 23 is another one. St. Francis' Prayer is another one. Let me be an instrument of your peace. Those kinds of things become tools for moving here. But mindfulness is also a very effective tool for finding that inner strength, that inner goodness that we all have from the beginning, original goodness,
right,
and blessing. And so this is going to be a loving kindness is one of those tools.
Would you like to start with that or with this?
Start with that and then do the loving kindness.
Okay. And just one additional thing I want to mention about prayer, and this is, again, is my view or my perspective, is that I view prayer as speaking out to the divine or God or higher power or universe, and I view meditation as a spirit speaking to us. So I'd like to share something with you from Maya Angelou. This is a prayer with the title of prayer. Divine, thank you for your presence during the hard and mean days, for then we have you to lean upon. Thank you for your presence during the bright and sunny days, for then we can share that which we have with those who have less. And thank you for your presence during the holy days, for then we are able to celebrate you and our families and our friends. For those who have no voice, we ask you to speak. For those who feel unworthy, we ask you to pour your love out in waterfalls of tenderness. For those who live in pain, we ask you to bathe them in the river of your healing. For those who are lonely, we ask you to keep them company. For those who are depressed, we ask you to shower upon them the light of hope. Dear Creator, you, the borderless sea of substance, we ask you to give to all the world that which we need most. Peace. So now we move into Kairos.
Okay. Lead us in the loving kindness practice.
Yes.
Thank you.
Yeah. Sure. So I just invite you to be in a comfortable position. You may want to place both feet on the floor. It might help you to feel a little bit more centered, more grounded. And just taking a few moments to tune into the breath within your body. And the invitation is to close your eyes or gently lower your gaze if that feels more comfortable for you. In a way, this could help to enhance the mind-body connection. So the loving kindness practice, the inclination, really is to turn our hearts and our minds toward a greater sense of kindness and compassion to the world and to ourselves. So I'm going to suggest a few practices. However, I invite you to include your own if that resonates more with you. So I'm going to ask you to bring someone to mind you feel a connection with. And this could be a good friend or an intimate partner, loved one, even a pet. And imagine them sitting in front of you and getting a sense of your heart in this moment, perhaps placing a hand over your heart. And with intention saying to this person, may you be happy and healthy. May you be safe and protected from harm. and may you experience inner peace and ease. So once again, tuning into your breath within your body, reconnecting with your heart. And now I now invite you to incline your heart and your mind towards yourself and saying to yourself, may I be happy and healthy. May I be safe and protected from harm. May I experience inner peace and ease. And now the invitation is to expand this sense of heartfulness and intention throughout the entire world, all countries, all people, saying to them, may you be happy and healthy. May you be safe and protected from harm. And may you experience inner peace and ease. And now again, just taking a few moments to focus on the breath and the inhale and the exhale. And before we bring this practice to a close, there's a quote I'd like to share with you from Maya Angelou. She said, my mission in life is not merely to survive, but to thrive. And to do so with some passion, some compassion, some humor, and some style.
All right, so I'm going to thank you so much.
You're welcome.
I really appreciate
You're
that.
Welcome.
I wonder if we can also thank her, maybe.
Oh,
and the only other, just before she leaves, one thing that I found particularly profoundly transformative was when we added to that loving kindness specifically someone we disliked, someone we really think is bad, and may they experience happiness, and may they experience a sense of ease. May they experience this loving kindness.
Mm-hmm.
The more we can pray for our enemies in that way, it begins to change us as well. And so that's just a beautiful practice, as well as all these other things. Thanks so much for sharing that with us.
My pleasure.
The band's going to come up and do one of my favorite songs, and they're going to do a song that I intentionally chose because I found out that if you look up the word prayer and you look up its root meanings, you know, the root meaning of belief is not a concept or an idea. The root meaning of belief is actually a relationship. It's actually to love. And the root meaning of prayer, if you look at the Aramaic, well, if you look at the Hebrew, the meaning of prayer is justice, right? Relationship. If you look at the Aramaic, it means to catch. It means to invite and catch. So this song seemed really appropriate for us as we think about our practice of prayer. So thanks again.
There's a place I go to when no one knows me. I'm not lonely, it's a necessary thing. It's a place I made up, find out what I made of. The nights I stayed up, counting stars and fighting sleep. Let it wash over me, ready to lose my feet. Take me on to the place where one reveals life's mystery. Steady on down the line, lose every sense of time. Take it all in and wake up that small part of me. Day to day I'm blind to see and find how far to go. Everybody's got the reason, everybody's got the way. We're just catching and release what builds up throughout the day. It gets into your body, goes right through your blood. We can tell each other secrets and remember all of them. La 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 la. La da da da, la da da da, la da 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 da, la da da da, la da da. Da, 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 da. can be terrifying to be slowly dying, also clarifying. We end where we begin. Let it wash over me. Ready to lose my feet. Take me on to the place where one reveals life's mystery. Steady on down the line. Lose every sense of time. Take it all in the wake of that small part of me. Day to day I'm blind to see. Find how far to go. Everybody's got the reasons. Everybody's got the way. We're just catching and releasing what we're talking about today. Gets into your body. Flows right through your blood. We can tell each other secrets.
So, you know, as I'm listening to that song and I'm thinking about why we're here and stuff and why you all are here and why do you come every, well, you don't come every Sunday, but why you come often, you know, why you come back often. And I think a lot of that is because this is challenging. It opens us up. It opens our mind. It reminds us that worship is not about something necessarily otherness as it is about finding worth. That's literally what the word worship means, is to find the worth. Because the worth, as Paul Tillich would say, the theologian, and others would say, the worth is in the very ground of our being. The worth is there. It's we, the ones that just don't see it or that we don't tap into it. And so that when we invite the presence of our enemies to be at table, it's not so that we can go na-na-na-na-na-na-na. That's not what that means. What that means is invite them to the table because we don't understand. We know there's something that connects us all. So let's listen. Let's figure out if we can find the connection. So that prayer is not about self-preservation. Prayer is about self-expansion. Prayer is about any opportunity we have to be enlarged. So if you're afraid of wokeness, for example, and you hide against it, you're afraid. Self-preservation. That's not what prayer is. Prayer is about expanding and recognizing how we're interconnected and finding those connections and facing the fear, because the fear doesn't come from anywhere but from within. So we catch and release and we catch and release. Mindfulness is a wonderful tool to get there. This song, let me ask you, was this a Christian song? Well, was it a Christian song? See, that's what we're talking about. What does it even mean once we move past belief into practice? So, go from this place. Let's stand for our benediction. It's real simple today. Let it all unravel, and it will become a beautiful path on which to travel. Amen.